underneath the trees. We watch the sky, confusing stars.
Everyone, welcome to Heart for the Community and heartforradio.com. We're actually in Los Angeles in our new studio with RMC in Los Angeles. And sitting next to me is my producer, Catherine Francis. Hi, Catherine.
Hi, how are you doing?
Good. So it's been a pretty interesting couple of days, huh?
Yes, it has been extremely adventurous, to say the least.
Yes. So we're both really excited about being here today. We have an exciting show. We're actually going to be talking about grassroots coalition building. You know, since this is an election year, you know, maybe giving our listeners some tips on how to do that, how to find out about what bills are coming out, what are the topics that, you know, their candidates are pushing, and yeah, kind of.
Well, and that's very important because a lot of people are so passionate about different things, so it's always important to know who we're supporting and who's supporting the causes that we support, particularly in our community. So, yes, I'm excited about that.
So, on the phone today, we have Ms. Daphne Kwok, and she is the Executive Director of the Asian Pacific Islanders with Disabilities of California. She was also appointed by President Obama to chair the White House Commission for Asian American and Pacific Islanders Initiatives. And where I first met Daphne, when she was the former executive director of OCA National. So, Daphne, how are you?
Good morning. Good morning. It's great to be with you, Doreen and Catherine, and congratulations on your new studio. Wow, that's pretty cool. So I can now say I know somebody that has their own radio studio. That's cool.
Thank you.
Thank you, Daphne. Good morning to
you. Good morning.
So, Daphne, why don't you share with our listeners a little bit more about your background? You know, I just sort of gave the highlights, but, you know, I really want our listeners to know who you are and what you've done in the community.
Sure. Well, thank you for this great opportunity. I will say I am a Chinese American. I was actually born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. My parents are immigrants from China who came to the States back in the late 50s for higher education. And we grew up actually literally inside the Washington, D.C. Beltway in Annandale, Virginia, which is in Northern Virginia. And I have to say at that time, growing up in the 60s, 70s in Northern Virginia, even though it was Washington, D.C., it was not very diverse, and there were certainly not many Asian Americans out on the East Coast. My father worked for the Veterans Administration. He worked for the federal government. And we were, I would say, a pretty non-typical Chinese-American family. My parents were extremely progressive for their generation. But we did grow up with the music, you know, with the violin and piano. And I have to say that even though we were in D.C., politics and current events was never a dinner conversation for us. It was really around our music and our schoolwork. But it was in high school that I decided that I would maybe try to start an organization, and I went to a public school, high school, where there were literally 2,000 students, and probably less than three dozen of us were students of color. Most of them were international students. So I started an international club. It wasn't until college, really, I went to Wesleyan University in Connecticut, that I really started to have Asian American classmates. And for me, that was thrilling. So out of a class of 650 freshmen at the time in the early 1980s, 29 of us were Asian American and Asian or Asian American. And that was the first time I actually had classmates. So I got very heavily involved with the Wesleyan Asian Interest Group. At that time, we had people interested in Asia mixed with East Asian Studies majors, mixed with Asian American students, to come together. And so that was really how I started to learn about Asian American issues, primarily from my classmates who grew up in California, especially those that were of Japanese American ancestry whose families were interned. I had never heard about the internment of the Japanese Americans. And so through that, I really became conscious about the issues impacting the Asian American community. I have to say, I would have loved to have been an Asian American studies major. That's my dream someday, is to really learn more and go study Asian American studies. But I ended up learning that on the job. When I returned back to D.C. after graduating, I sort of started to join groups, and there were not many at that time in the mid-1980s in D.C., Asian American community, but I got involved with OCA, got involved with the local chapter, started to take leadership roles there, worked for the Organization of Chinese American Women, and sort of one thing led to another. It was a relatively small, active, engaged Asian American community in D.C. I somehow got very heavily involved in Democratic Party politics. I have to say, I didn't know the difference between a Democrat and Republican at that time. But the people I was hanging around with and the people involved with these social justice organizations and political leaders at that time were, at that time, Congressman Norman Mineta of San Jose, Congressman Bob Matsui of Hawaii, Congresswoman Patsy Mink of Hawaii, Congressman Bob Matsui of Sacramento, California. And so I sort of got very heavily involved in Democratic Party politics, very specifically Asian American Democratic Party politics. And since it was a small community and I was willing to put in time and effort into it, they have really become my mentors, people like Norman Mineta, who continue to this day to be a tremendous mentor. And so I sort of fell into it, and I became executive director of OCA. It was a national civil rights organization, really the only organization, Asian community, headquartered in Washington, D.C., with chapters throughout the country. Our sister organization, the Japanese American Citizens League, was based in San Francisco, but with a D.C. lobbying office. So in 1990, there were exactly four people working on behalf of the entire national AAPI community in the area of civil rights. I have to say, this was almost pre-computer, pre-email days, and almost in the dark ages at that time. But it was pretty daunting, and the only way we could get our work done as small nonprofit organizations was really to work in coalition. And so I'm a huge advocate of coalition work, first of all within the Asian American community, and second of all within the civil rights community. Some of my closest friends and allies and peers were my colleagues from like the NAACP, National Council of La Raza, Mexican-American Legal Defense and Education Fund, through the unions like the AFL-CIO, the National Education Association, and the Jewish community, American Jewish Committee. Mm-hmm. We were all part of the Leadership Conference on Civil Rights, and it was really only through that kind of coalition work that for us as a growing Asian-American voice, and we're still growing, we could learn from really the best of the best. And so I've been fortunate in my career to work in a number of Asian American nonprofit organizations, working really to empower Asian Americans in the political process as well as in the area of civil rights. And currently I am based now in San Francisco as executive director of Asians and Pacific Islanders with Disabilities of California, really working to bring people with disabilities to the table as well. And it's really been capped in the last few years with a tremendous honor of being appointed by President Obama to chair his Advisory Commission on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders so that we have a voice at that federal table as well. So I my motto in life, I keep telling people, is that my work is my play and my play is my work, and I feel very fortunate to be able to say that.
Well, we can definitely relate to that, Daphne. We feel the same way about the work that we do.
Yeah,
thank
wonderful.
You so much.
You know, and I mean, looking back, I mean, you were really part of that sort of pioneer, you know, group of AAPI civil rights, you know, leaders. And, you know, at the time, I'm sure it didn't really feel like that. You were just focused on, you know, the mission and what was, you know, the action items and the tasks ahead of you. And, you know, when you look at coalition building, for our listeners who may have a passion about something, but they're not quite sure, you know, where to start, what suggestions or strategies might you give them on, you know, how to begin?
Well, I really encourage people, when I talk to people, to be involved, whatever your passion may be, whether it's working with the homeless, whether it's working with youth, whether it's working with seniors, and really find the organizations in your locale, local area that are working. They're always looking for volunteers. They're always looking for people who are willing to take leadership roles. But really sign up and start with an organization, whatever that issue area might be. It's interesting how small, in some sense, those worlds might be. Once you get engaged in an area, you get to quickly know who the main organizations are, who the main players are. And that really is a great opportunity to network. And I think we often use the word networking. It's I would say a term that is not overused. It is truly, I think, what makes people able to be successful in the work they do is really through their contacts and their networks. And it's through those networks that you get to learn about other opportunities, even if you're looking for a job opportunity in the area of passion that you may have. It all comes from those informal networks that may lead to whether it's job opportunities or other volunteer opportunities. I would really encourage people also to take leadership roles. It's very, very important to take leadership roles so that you continue to gain skills and also that you can be recognized and be acknowledged for the work that you're doing if you want to continue to move in those circles of whatever issue area that you might select. But, you know, and you have to approach it, too, as fun, as that you enjoy it, and hopefully that you feel that you are being able to give back to the community and whatever that community may be. But I think it's all very, very important for all of us as part of our citizenship, as part of being engaged Americans here in our communities. We need to all of us need to give back in some respect, in some regard, and through volunteer service is really one of the best ways.
I have a question for you, Daphne, and we often talk about leadership, and a lot of times we celebrate so many of our leaders, such as Cesar Chavez, Martin Luther King, but oftentimes as we look at that, we kind of say, well, I'm not a Martin Luther King, I'm not this kind of a leader, but I think you hit on something so vitally important, and that is that you just start off kind of just working in an area that you're passionate about, and now you've been appointed by President Obama. I'm sure you never thought that that would happen, and maybe you did, I'm not sure.
I would never have thought that.
So can you talk a little bit, or just kind of maybe just briefly kind of share with our listeners, what does that pathway look like, in a kind of maybe in a, if you had to do it in a 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of step, what did that look like? Again, maybe starting with your passion, because again, so many of our youth, they have these passions, but they kind of look at these great leaders because we idolize them. And of course, they've done some phenomenal work. But the reality of it was they were just people who were passionate and people who just kept moving in the direction of their goals and their dreams and the things that they wanted to see accomplished.
Well, I'll use myself as an example because I think maybe it is a great example of what you're talking about. I have to say that graduating from college, I went back home. I had no idea. I didn't even have a job. My mom had to use her, her influence with her friend. Oh, can you please hire Daphne? She needs a job. And I never would have expected to be in the work that I'm doing now. First of all, there was no Asian American community when I was growing up. The other thing I tell people is I was extremely, very, very shy growing up. And I have to say, even through college. And I dreaded the college classes that graded you on class participation because I would just be so fearful of going to class, you know, trying to figure out what was I going to speak up and say. For me, and just seeing and using my own personal career as an example, I would never expected, and my parents and their my parents' friends to this day would never expected me, out of all the kids in my generation, to be where I am today because I was so extremely shy. And now to be representing the president, to be, you know, speaking at the White House, to be in meetings with the president and with members of Congress, whoever it might be, people have never expected it. But it's because of my passion I fell into really working and loving and working on behalf of the community, the people I started to work with, and it was a very small community, as I mentioned, in the 1980s that was active and involved. You know, once you say that you're willing to do X, Y, and Z, people notice that, and if you deliver on X, Y, and Z, boy, you sort of start rising up the ladder. You might not know it, but you get...
And I'm going to have you hold that point, and we're going to take a quick break.
Okay, thank you.
So we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be right back with Daphne, and she's going to continue to talk about kind of her path and the steps she took to becoming appointed by President Obama.
I can almost see it.